Morning, everyone. I hope you are doing well. I've just returned from this amazing trip on the Danube River, and I want to share a few highlights of my experience there on a historical level. One of the sites that was absolutely incredible, something that I was completely unprepared for, and really it took me back, and I've been reflecting on it for quite a while. Specifically, I'm speaking about the tomb of the Chasam Sofer, also pronounced Hatam Sofer, who was a very important 18th century rabbi in Pressburg, later and currently known as Bratislava, the capital of Slovakia. It's really an amazing monument to a phenomenal individual, and I'd just like to walk you through the experience of visiting this place. So here's a map, first of all, of where Slovakia is and where Bratislava is. It was a home of a very important Jewish community, second only in the region, really, to Vienna. And in fact, when Vienna had some of its most anti-Semitic moments in the 15th century, and in the 17th century, Slovakia and Bratislava, then known as Pressburg, or in Yiddish, Pressburg, actually absorbed quite a few of the Viennese refugees. The Hatam Sofer is buried by the Danube River, and there's an amazing story about the construction of his tomb, but let's walk through it as I experienced it, and I'll try and, you know, take you through the amazing impression that it made on me. So first of all, when you walk up there, you see this mound before you realize you're coming to a graveyard, because the graves are largely absent, as we shall see shortly. There's this sort of like a tell, like, you know, one of those archaeological hills, and it has these beautiful symmetrical glass obelisks rising from the grass. They're all in a faint sort of aqua teal hue. They're not entirely identical. Some are pebbled, some are transparent, but they stand like silent sentinels on this mound. And then beside the mound, there's this massive black rectangular box that, you know, sort of slices into the mound itself. It has a dramatic slot-like entrance at one end, and that's how you access the tomb itself. In a way, you actually walk underground. It's like you enter into the underworld itself to encounter the grave of the Chasam Sofer, and there's a tremendous amount of anticipation and even trepidation as you go through the narrow entrance. Let's just back up a little bit and understand how this unusual came to be. So here's a historical photograph of this 17th century cemetery, which had several thousand Jewish graves right on the bank of the Danube River. When the region fell to the local fascists in World War II, their leader decided to simply eradicate this Jewish graveyard. And the Jewish community of Bratislava, this is immediately prior to the deportations that destroyed most of them, begged Tiso, the leader, to at least allow them to re-enter the graves. This was grudgingly granted, and several thousand graves were moved up the hill to the newer Jewish cemetery. But there were a clutch of really important graves surrounding the Hatam Sofer himself, and perhaps on the payment of a large bribe, perhaps because there was a rumor of a curse that went along with disturbing the bones of this holy rabbi, the Tiso agreed to allow those bones to remain in place. But he had intentions to pave over the entire region, so he allowed a concrete sarcophagus to be constructed over a series of those graves. Here you can see in this historical photograph how they're actually sealed in a hollow box of concrete that protected them from the elements, but essentially shut them off from any visitors. And then shortly after the war, plans went ahead, and you can see here that the graves were actually completely paved over. The communists, however, fell in the 20th century, and a new movement arose at the beginning of the 21st century to resurrect the graves, or to at least gain access to the graves with a fitting memorial for the Chasam Sofer. An international consortium was working with the Bratislava Jewish community to try and create a new monument and memorial, and they engaged this local architect named Kvasnitsa, who was actually quite brilliant. He had Martin Kavnitsa had never constructed much Jewish monuments, although he had worked with the chief rabbi shown here on the left, Rabbi Baruch Myers, a Chabad Shliach, who's originally from New Jersey. On the right, by the way, is my colleague David Krauss, a Jewish historian from Prague. They received permission to begin construction, and Kavnitsa did a lot of research into the halachic background of the proper treatment of graves in Jewish tradition, and with the guidance of the local committee, he designed this absolutely phenomenal memorial. So let's go back now to the actual structure of the monument so you get a sense of how powerful this is. Here's a view from the entrance to the tomb, a narrow kind of slot that's rather foreboding and dark. It is open to the sky like a traditional ohel, like you have, for example, with the Lubavitcher Rebbe, but it descends downward into this closed space. There is an immediate 90-degree left-hand turn, and immediately before that turn, there's this sign here in four languages that essentially says, as you can see, this is a sacred place, and there's some warning about appropriate conduct and dress. What I find interesting is that the translations are almost identical, but the Hebrew one has one slight difference. The first three words reads, Makom Kadosh Lefanecha. This is a holy place before you, meaning there's like kind of a first, second person relationship with this for Hebrew readers, that for everyone who visits this site, it's a sacred place. But for you, Lefanecha, this is a Makom Kodesh, or something special because of the Chasam Sofer's impact on Jewish tradition. So when you make that left-hand turn, there's an anteroom, and you will enter the gravesite of the Chasam Sofer. Here is a photograph of the Chasam Sofer himself, a rendition of the Chasam Sofer. He was first and foremost a posek, meaning a decisor of Jewish law. His most important contribution to Jewish history, other than his incredible scholarship and leadership of this very important yeshiva in Pressburg, was the fact that he dealt with extremely difficult times for the Jewish people. This era, the late 18th and early 19th century, were suffused with internal conflict as the various European nations were debating exactly how to deal with the Jewish minority. Should they be given complete emancipation? Can they be trusted to be equal citizens? Will they not have dual loyalties? Or will they not engage in, you know, inappropriate or even criminal conduct? And so many Jews were advocating almost slavish imitation of European norms in an attempt to try and win the confidence of the dominant population and then be granted political emancipation. In some places, this meant just outright conversion. In fact, there is a massive wave of conversions to Christianity by Jews who feel like really the only way they're going to access modern European culture is through becoming a Christian. Heinrich Heine, the great poet of Germany at this time, even famously said that baptism was his ticket to European culture, and many Jews chose that route. Others chose a more moderate route, like, for example, Rabbi Samson Raphael Hirsch in Frankfurt am Main, who argued that in order to cope with the challenges of the freedoms of modernity, Jews must examine the tradition carefully and separate those things which are, strictly speaking, absolutely mandatory and those things which are simply fashionable or customary that have been added on but are not necessarily essential to the observance of Judaism. This eventually would become what we call modern Orthodoxy, the bastion of which is the Yeshiva University in New York City, for example, and a philosophy that, of course, animates many Jews today. The Chasam Sofer, on the other hand, advocated a strong resistance position in which he argued that, no, in fact, the benefits of modernity are far outweighed by the dangers that it presents, that, and he was correct in this, that modernity would entail tremendous assimilation, would entail tremendous spiritual and demographic losses in the Jewish people. And he said something which was very appropriate for his population, his region in particular, that Jews should draw a hard line in the sand and say, no, we are not going to adapt to modernity, we are going to resist modernity. This eventually became the fundamental philosophy of the Haredi movements, which have outposts in Israel, in North America, in Europe, which, although it's impossible to completely shut out modernity, we still, you know, use modern technology, for example, and things like that. But Haredim have a very distrustful attitude towards many aspects of modernity, and will proceed with extreme caution with regards to adopting new social norms and so on. So his most famous slogan was based on a Talmudic dictum, which is taken out of context, but nevertheless makes sense in the overall scope of his teaching. He wrote, Chadash Asur Min HaTorah, which normally meant a particular kind of wheat was forbidden by the laws of the Torah, but the literal translation is, new is forbidden by the Torah. And he meant to say, it's a little bit of a pun, that which is new we should regard as forbidden by the Torah. This is an indication of the strong ideological position that he articulated and had extreme impact. So let's look at what happens when you actually get into the grave itself. It's rather stunning. So you actually walk into the box that was formed by the sarcophagus. It has a sloping roof, and directly above the 23 odd graves that are still interred there are the what appear to be the bottom edges of those green sentinels that stand above ground. And suddenly you grasp on an architectural level that there is a connection between the world of the dead and the world of the living, that the influence of these holy Jews resonates in the surface world by somehow rising through the barrier of the earth into the world of those who walk in the day. It's a rather amazing, poetic, visual experience when you walk into this somber place and you feel that connection between the living and the dead. It's really, really quite overwhelming. The graves are all laid out, and the Chasam Sofer, as you see here on the left, is the largest among them. All of the people buried here are of great importance to the Pressburg community in particular, and have had made phenomenal contributions to the community at large. So, wow. That's the experience of going into the grave there. It's really an amazing thing. It's definitely worth visiting if you get to Pressburg, or to Bratislava, excuse me. I hope you enjoyed this very brief video travelogue. And for those of you who follow me regularly, I urge you to rejoin us as we begin our lecture series this coming Monday with a lecture on the Or Zeruah, Yitzchak of Vienna, an early Rishon from the period. Thank you very much for listening.